The drums echoing tonight, and she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. The moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words. Melodies. He turned to me as if to say, "Hurry, boy, it's waiting there for you." Gonna take a life to drag me away from you. There's nothing that 100 men or more could ever do. I bless the rain.
dogs cry out in the night as they grow restless, longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right, sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti. I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
actually gonna try by voice because I got some drops in the throat. Let's see if this works. Second. Can you guys hear me just fine or no? Let me know, because it's actually healing my throat. Thank you. All right, so no, it's not a corona. Trust me. All right. Basically, what we did yesterday was try to manage to create this curve, right, which is we create here, and then we resample a lot of things. And one of the mistakes, an error that I was doing, if you actually was watching yesterday, this curvature part was giving some elements by the make skill independent. And also, there was another issue, which is, let me see, I don't remember necessarily what it was. Let me see here. Oh yeah, so one of the resamples were not actually output as polygon. That's why the triangulation to 2D over here was causing so many problems. So now, anything that we do through this curve, it would actually work. So I'm just gonna go and use the contents of the stylized terrain. And then let's try to see no link. Perfect. This link is basically what happens is you can make a node just be visible over here, but we don't want any links. Therefore, it would pretty much say whatever you have as the or the selection mode, for example. Now you're going to be able to see the curve itself of each selection. So that's a good thing about it. So I'm going to put on the normals. And let's edit the curve. So now you can see that the triangle A2D is working and the noises are happening surrounding the silhouette of the curve. And there was another thing that I wanted to add and make sure that we had. I'm going to press, make sure that the background is dark. Can you guys listen to me or hear me just fine? Please let me know. Give me feedback. Let me see. I'm going to take off the, take around the grid off. So this noise has this attribute which is called offset, right? And this offset is whatever actually offsets the noise surrounding the bound areas of the shape. So I actually wanted to make sure that I add this here. So I'm gonna edit the interface real quick. I'm gonna put as macro. I'm gonna put it C. Yeah, right at the top. And call macro noise offset. I'm just gonna call it offset because honestly, we already have macro as the menu right there. So I'm just gonna make sure that this is gone. Thank you. I appreciate the feedback, man. I really appreciate it. How are you guys doing, by the way? Everyone doing okay? Over here in US, I don't know if everyone is in US, but I'm sure plenty of people are probably all over the world, but in the US, I think we have until May 2nd. If anyone from US can correct me, I'm not even following. As a quarantine. Alright. Now that I did this with this offset and I have the node over here, I'm going to copy this parameter and forgive me for my voice and paste the relative reference over here. You can paste in all of them, but to me, it doesn't matter actually. They just optimize the time of doing anything else. So now I am able to offset the noise over there. And you can offset as well the same thing over this noise. Where is it? Actually, let's put the same color for those guys because honestly, I was getting sort of lost yesterday. And put the same shape. There you go. And then we can bring that same offset over to this, because honestly, offset is offsetting no matter what. It's just basically a seeding parameter. And there you go. And then this offset can actually be global. I mean, it doesn't have to be macro or anything like that. So I'm just going to put that there. There you go. So that we have the shape. So this is basically what we created yesterday. I just wanted to give you guys a review If you didn't watch the video, it's available on YouTube. And what I'm gonna do as well now is create the solid part of it, right? How actually we are able to create the clips up or down. If anyone has votes to go up or down, let me know. But I'm gonna go up. It's okay to say if you want to go down, wait, I can show you as well. The idea is we're gonna go to perspective. And basically I wanna make sure that it's kinda like a valley. So I'm gonna change the curve real quick over here so we can make sure that we have enough room for that to happen. Again, the grid. So yeah, basically if you bring the nodes, I can actually delete some of those guys. I'm not probably gonna need as much. And you can always add more. So all right, put it. So yeah, one of the things that I don't like, I'm not used to it at least, is if you press shift and you press the button right there in the grid, if you move a little bit, the red line, it's gonna allow you to go up on the y-axis, and I usually don't like that. Perfect. Let me just do a little bit of offsetting. No, you didn't miss anything in the 30 minutes, my man, genius, because honestly, I was just, you missed it from the other one? I don't know. Yesterday, you can watch on YouTube again if you want to. It's available on my channel. So I'm just going to make some scale and differentiation. Okay, we can always change this later. So now, what I want to do is create some walls for this hill. And I'm gonna go to the macro detail first, okay? And all the little things that are gonna happen, the hill later, we can do it. But for now, it's gonna be this way. So we know that we have this skin curve right here, right? Which is the shape form of the copy points. So what I wanna do is, instead of actually using this skin for the lines of the walls, I'm going to make sure that I have only the rows. The columns, which is that, okay? So you guys can see that the noise is happening there, but the problem of this is, here's one thing. We need to copy and make sure that we have all those noises in the same spot and whatever this is being created. So if we bring, I'll go to the end of the curve, you're gonna see that we have all of that, plenty of nodes, but the fortunate thing is I'm able to create a subnetwork node over here, so I'm gonna do that right now. I'm gonna save the file, make sure that we have it. And I'm gonna bring this whole thing into a subnetwork, let me see. Right mouse button. I'm gonna collapse this. Basically, yeah, so go to any node, right mouse button, actions, and collapse to subnet. What this does is every single thing gets inside of a subnetwork, so it kind of makes sure to makes sense to organize. So we're just gonna call this micro detail, micro noise detail, I guess. And I'm gonna put a color, boom. Actually, not this one, this is one bad. And make sure we have anything that is different so I understand that this is actually a subnetwork. And I'm gonna create a reference copy for this guy. So basically what happens is, now every single thing that I change on here, it's gonna go there. The problem is all of those attributes or everything that is on the noise side of things, those guys are not necessarily imbued. So like we'll have to test them. So basically if I change this, and I'm viewing this, I'm gonna template this and see if it's the same, right? So you can see that the same thing is happening over there, which is nice. So we have both the same. One of the things that I forgot is we have this skin node over here, which we do not want right now, but we want outside of this. So I'm gonna make sure that we have outside. Connect that guy in and bring it here. Perfect. Because then we have the two different nodes right there. Okay. And then now we are able to, let's just say, I do not want to use the triangle A2D because actually I only want those lines to be happening. So now we're going to have to do this. Actually, I need to think for a second because I could do something different here. Let me see what happens if I kill the triangulate 2D. Just bring the divide. Resample. Okay. Yeah, I think this actually might work better. So I'm just going to kill the triangulate 2D over here. I'm going to bring it outside. Okay, and then let's see if it matches. So right now it's not matching because I probably selected the wrong thing. Cool. Okay, but now we don't need this triangulate 2D and neither the skin. So now we have the same curve right over there. But again, this is supposed to be the copy of the other one. It didn't go through though, I don't know why. So I'm gonna delete that guy and then copy the reference again. Oh, this is actually not going to work so well, to be honest with you guys, because, let me see. Well, it's actually working just fine. I thought that, again, I didn't know, that those attributes or whatever it's inside, it wouldn't be copied to the reference node unless it's just the parent attributes right here, but that's fantastic that it does. All right, now I want to make sure that I have the walls, which we can do in many different ways. Okay, guys, it's just the way Houdini works is it's like insane how the many amount of ways. So we're gonna try things here and there. So bear with me. I'm gonna put let's see. I'm gonna create a for each connected piece for now. So we make sure that we have two lines, right? So we don't necessarily want both of them. And I'm gonna be able to have just one shape, one form, as you can see. And I'm gonna be able to call it both of them right here. Okay, so I'm gonna create an extrude for now. Everything's gonna be experimental here. Please bear with me. I don't necessarily know all the solutions. I just go and keep trying different things in order to find out. Let's do perhaps 20, but then this needs to be global. Perfect. So yeah, this extrude node is causing that guy to go up. So if we end up like bringing both of them, you can see that we have that. But the back face is, this is the reason why I'm saying like I may not know everything. I will have to find out what we actually need to do. This guy is causing it, the wall over here, okay, to be, as you can see, the back faces are not the same, which is not a good idea. So we're going to have to change things here and there. What we can do is, let me see, we can try to reverse one of them. So as I go to the reverse node, I'm able to choose a group of whatever this is happening. So I'm gonna bring this gentleman right here. And we know that we have two primitives right here. So if I press this guy right here, which I guess it's gonna be hard to see this. I'm gonna try to increase the size of, no. One sec. Well, okay, I'm not gonna spend your guys' time. Basically, there's a zero and one right there. So there's two groups, and I mean, he knows that there's two elements. That's what we wanna do. So I'm gonna make sure that I have the primitive zero right here, for example, right? So it's gonna only select that one. And whenever I select the group one, which is, I'm gonna call it this reverse. And I don't know if you guys know any of our option of like automatically, whenever you change a group, automatically does in everything that is selected. Please let me be aware. You can manually do it, I know, but I would love to have like automatic. And now that I know that this is reversed, how do I know that it's reversed? That's, it's kind of difficult to see. Then we'll have to create like attributes and everything like that, but you can see the sorting order of the points. So I probably don't know if the stream you're gonna be able to see the numbers, but if you go here, you should have reversed the points. Oh, it didn't. Let me think. Oh, I know why. Okay, so instead of actually using the reverse, we can use the sort node. And the sort node, I am going to reverse this guy. So you see reversed everything. We don't necessarily want that because we want to reverse just one of the curves. In order to do that, unfortunately, I'm going to have to create a split. And in this split node, I'm going to be able to change, just select the group 0, for example, and I reverse the thing. Let's go there and do the merge. And as I put the merge node, I get that. And then let's see if this works. I'm not sure if it's going to work, but that way it did not work. Okay, I think it's probably just the normals themselves. So let's put a reverse. Yeah, there you go. It was the freaking reverse. Anyway, apologize. Now that I have this, I'm going to take those numbers off. And instead of actually using the walls themselves, I only want to have the curves of it, right? So we can do this. We can do, instead of actually using refuse, I'm not going to leave the polyextrude over there, but I'm rather just copy transform. Let's see if I can do that. I'm going to put in copy and transform. And I'm going to bring that to be, I'm actually going to do a float over here and make sure that I have a node called, I mean a parameter called height, cliff height. And also I'm going to do a sort of like a separator and make sure that we have a label. And in this label, I'm going to call it cliffs. Apply, okay. And then copy this parameter and bring it the translation right here. And now I'm able to have this parameter right there. Let's see if it works. Perfect. And then through the aspect of that, we know that we have the first line, right? And I copy transform, I created the other one, okay? I'm able to create a skin in between the two. And this is what happens, right? So it's pretty much the idea of the extrude, but the thing is, the good thing about it. Let's just put that over here, so test. Okay, so it's going outside because it doesn't necessarily know how to find the normals themselves. So we're gonna see if I'm able to change the, yeah, let's do that. Yeah. And we can put a normal at the end so we can see what's gonna happen. If you guys think that the nodes are too far away or anything like that, please keep me posted. I'm gonna try with the interface here to bring things closer. And then, okay, so now that we have both walls, I don't know why the normals are, it was correct, Jesus, Hugo. Okay, so I need to not do this one. That guy. It may happen that actually the reverse normals, whenever I change the curve at the start of the graph, it will bring the polarity to the different sides. It's a little bit more complex to fix that. I will have to use some code, and I don't have the mindset to think about trigonometry right now. So I'm gonna just allow myself to just like by hand just fix that later. All right. We have the second curve, which is that guy on the top. So I'm gonna bring this for each loop down. And instead of actually using the skin, yeah, I'm gonna leave the skin right here, sure, why not? Or, no, I'm gonna do better. Stop being lazy, Hugo. All right, so we have the split right here, and we know that this split exists. So instead of actually using for each loop and connectivity or whatever we have here, I'm just simply gonna bring that guy in here so we can copy the same attributes, whatever we have later. Alright. So now we know that we are able to copy that guy, and we are able to have another height over here as well. If you want to make sure that we have the same height in both, you can totally do this by or having the attribute, or even changing over here on the side. So let's just say I want to have one of the cliffs to be higher than the other one. And you can see that that's going to happen right there. So it's up to you. I'm going to go a little simpler over here and not do this for now. Okay. Since we have the two groups over here, I'm going to be able to select the second primitive of this guy. So, and there's so many other different ways of creating that, but that's the first thing that I can think of. We know that the first one is zero, the other one is second. So I'm going to blast. Actually, delete. I'm gonna do another split actually. So we're gonna pretty much branch this out in order to have those shapes happening. There you go. Alright, so now this gentleman, I do want just the number one of the file. And over here, let's create a subnetwork. Because what I want to do is make sure that I have a different noise formation over here. So I'm going to copy things outside of whatever we had there, which is the micro noise, or actually I'm going to use, let me think. I'm actually going to create a new one because a lot of people didn't see. So, and I don't have to necessarily put a lot of effort into it. Let's put, I'm going to bring another attribute noise. Make sure that I connect that guy. And for a lot of people that didn't see the video yesterday, basically what this does, it creates the color of every single point has a different color with that, with a noise. I'm gonna make sure that this is called cliff noise so I can, I'm able to read the notes, put a color. Hope you guys are able to understand whatever I'm saying, or if I am telling. All right, so then instead of using additive, we can do 3D, and I'm gonna make sure that it's center noise. Okay, perfect. And I'm gonna create a. Actually, I want to make sure this isn't normal. So the normals are gonna be very fantastically noisy right there, and I'm gonna remap this noise, and you can see that while I remap this noise, it's more going to one direction than the other one. It's kind of positive to do so right now because you want the shape to actually go outside a little bit more for sort of like the canyon goes outside. So let's just test this real quick so we can have something happening to read. And I'm gonna make sure that I have a blur. We did this yesterday a lot. And bring the attribute as normal, and let's blur this guy out and not pin the points. Perfect. Because basically, I want to just offset, right? I still have that whole noise happening through the whole scenario right there, but I can do this and bring the peak. I do not want to recompute the normals, and now we're able to push this guy. Perfect. So now we go back there. I'm gonna just say, call this push normals. And we're gonna do a action, create reference copy. And I'm gonna save this guy here. Let's see if this works. We need to make sure that this split also exists on the other side. And let's see if this, yeah, okay. So let's see if this, no, it's not happening, 1 second. All right, so one of them is bringing dot one to another direction, and necessarily I think it's because of, let me think. It's a little bit confusing for myself as well here, 1 second. So this guy is the first one, the second, let's see. Oh yeah, you don't necessarily need this, sorry. What do you need is, okay, let's see if this works. little bit lost right now. Give me one second, guys. Oh, yeah. Okay. So this one goes there. Perfect. Okay, perfect. So you see that the normals are going in the different route right there, right? So if I don't know, I'm not sure why this is not necessarily reversing the normal over here. Because I already used the reverse there. I'm wondering if it's copying the group itself. So I'm going to try to bring this group right here. Oh, actually, we don't even need the group. Interesting. Yeah, it's not even, like, it's not doing even anything. Weird. Let me put a null node. I don't remember necessarily why the over there it did work and over here didn't. Hmm. Yeah, it's just changing. Okay, so basically what's doing is just changing the sorting of the normal. So what we have to do here, I'm going to show you guys. Bop. Actually, you can do easier. I'm going to create a wrangle. And this wrangle, select over there. And I'm going to put this as an expression of normal. Oops. Normal equals minus at normal. Let's see if this works. Yeah, perfect. So basically, this code right here will just reverse the normals themselves, because we actually don't want to use the sorting, but we want to make sure that the normals are going the other way. Perfect. Now that I have that, we're going to be able to hide it on the other side. There you go. Perfect. So I pushed both of them, and I have the push normals right here, and we're going to have both curves in different ways. Now that we have those, I'm just going to disconnect that guy because we know what we actually want here. So I'm going to bring that fellow right there and this guy as well here. And call skin for now. I'm not sure yet, but we'll see. So we know it's causing tons of issues. Let's see why. Oh yeah, I have to merge them both before I put the skin on, so. Kinda slow today, jeez. All right, so that's what it causes. So I basically had the other point right there, and I can do the same for the other one. And then we're gonna merge all of them together. As a preview purpose. Perfect. So now that we have that, we know that the reverse part of things, because of the skin, needed to exist, but after the fact that we created the other stuff. Great. So I'm gonna put a normal here. No, we don't. We don't need. Yeah, let me do something here. That's correct. Okay. So now we have this. We know that we have the micro noise from the floor, and we can merge that guy on the final merge as well. We're going to be able to just pretty much see everything happening. I know it's a reverse right now, so we have to... There you go. I don't know why I'm reversing this and the other guy is actually revert. It's funny, like... I'm really lost. Anyway. Perfect. Now we have the cliffs there, and you can see that the parts of the top are a little bit noisy too much, and it's kind of like causing some issues right here, and that is really bad. We can do some things to minimize that, which is increase the amount of blur of that, or we let's see if we just decreasing to see if it helps. Let me put it like 200. Seems a little bit better, but still, it's probably going to even cause issues, but I'm going to go this route for now, and we can always change it later. Let's see if this does the job. Perfect. And then I need to also make sure that this doesn't have any effect on the Y axis. Let's actually, I'm going to gotta fix this right now. So basically, the idea here is, again, use the measure note, right? After the blur, perhaps, it's fine. And we're gonna make sure that we have these 2 points, make sure that we have this curvature. Let's do strike curviness and put this as mean. And then put this color over there and bake in between 0 and 1. And we're able to see that it's gonna get only the curvatures, the curvature itself of the curve. But we may want some different settings over here in the curvature, because it's, I really want this part, like, which is the really broad one, right, of that, to actually smooth it out. I don't necessarily know the solution right now, but let's give it a try on some a few things here. No? Okay, trying different ways here. Might get like too complicated right now for you guys. Okay, so this may work, but the problem is actually getting just really tiny little ones, because we have so many points around the surface, and we wouldn't have as many points no matter what. But I want to try to do something here that will kind of make the curve a little bit smoother, and we're gonna rate back to whatever we had before. So we can try. And again, this tutorial, guys, it's pretty much experimentation. I don't necessarily know how this result's gonna be. I don't know. I'm not trying to, like, I don't have an art director on my back, like, asking me something specific. So I'm pretty much trying to show how our mind is able to actually play around with the Houdini for fun and still find out different things that we can do. Anyway. I'm gonna resample this guy. Boom. As you guys can see, it's resampling to be a lot. So I'm gonna put this as 10, perhaps. That's a little bit better. And I think there's a wire. Let me see. So I think it's a wire blend. Or wire that deform. Yeah. So I think it's too much right there, so I'm gonna bring it to 2, perhaps. No, a little bit more. And let's get this measure after the fact. And let's see if what this does. So you can see now that the white spots are a little bit more of the broadness side. So I'm able to actually even decrease this a little bit more. Okay. And let's put it as mean. Yeah, a little bit better. And 6 again. This way, we're going to be able to find the little parts that are a little bit more broad and fix the problem that we had before. So now we have the wire deform. I don't necessarily even know it's going to work, by the way. We have geometry deform, the rest wires, and I'm going to try to explain as much as I can to what happens here, and the deforming wires. What I want is this guy, which is the rest wire. Okay, I'm going to put it there. Let me see if its output is polygons. Okay, perfect. So you can see it changed a lot. So I'm gonna give you the measurement. Yeah, perfect. And then I bring the high one, which is this gentleman right here. And the measure one, after the fact, I will have to create a blur. And then make sure that this doesn't have the pin border corners, and I have the attribute, which is the curvature right here. I do want to make sure that this is 0, 1, because honestly it may cause issues later. So I'm gonna blur that guy and type curvature right here. Let's see if this works. Okay, perfect. And then let's see if we're able to minimize it. I wonder if I should use Gaussian or I'm going mean again. Let's try curviness and then mean. Well, yeah, I do want to make sure that the point 0 and 1 of the curve is actually not necessarily touched on by a attribute blur. I don't remember necessarily this. I think it was I can do PT num over here or something like that. Let me try. String that one. PT num. No, I don't think this is gonna work. PT minus. My God, a long time I don't even do this. For it, I think it's PT NPT, which is last group of the. Let me see if this works by a string. No, okay, I'm gonna have to do it by the regular way because I forgot what it is. So I'm gonna put a group range. I use a lot of the documentation for Houdini. For like reminding what functions are happening, but a long time I don't even use Houdini, like maybe 3-4 months, and then you forget. And I'm gonna make sure that this is endpoints. It's called endpoints, and then I want the one here, and it's points. Invert the range, and you can see now it's selecting the first point on the curve and the last, and I'm able to say, hey. Do not use the group called endpoints. So I put exclamation point. So now if I smoothed it out, you'll see that no matter what, it's not gonna change that, okay? Perfect. Since I have that, I'm able to put this deformation curve and let's see what is there. Same mirror, let me see where I can. Oh. So apparently there's a wire capture that I have created first. Let's see what it does. Geometry capture, which is probably this guy. Wires to capture with, I think it's this. Okay, fair enough. Visualize weighting, let's see if I can see something. Perfect. And I believe this goes here. Yeah, there you go. Let me take off the visualization. Let's see if this changes anything. And let's blur this more. Yeah, so basically now this wire capture, I think there's a fall off and scale, so I have to find. Nope. Okay, so fall off start, pretty much the idea is if I visualize this, it's pretty much, I want the whole thing to actually be captured. So it's gonna entirely smooth the whole thing. So now if I bring this out, so you can see that instead of actually having those really deep lines, I'm smoothing out a little bit of the end, and I don't want to visualize ending here. Let's see if this works. I'm gonna save it, and of course I want to peek it, and I probably forgot that the normals do get recomputed with a wire, so let's see. Yeah, compute point normals. So we may actually end up wanting the blur. I'm blurring here, so instead of blurring here, I'm gonna actually bring those parameters there. And I'm thinking, one second, guys. Yeah, and then over here, there you go. I hope that's what's gonna work, but we'll see. Now I go back, you'll see that at least the tops are a little more smoothed out, which is nice. And since I have this push normals going here, I really want to make sure that I have the variable. Oh, my throat is killing me. I want to make sure that I have the variable available of that blur. I'm going to copy this guy right here. And I'm going to make sure that I have this called top blur curve, I guess. I don't know. Since it's just one attribute, I'm going to leave it that way. And I want to make sure that I have the range to be like perhaps 500. Save this guy. And now I know that I'm able to copy this parameter and go back in, save, and copy and paste relative references on this blur. I don't know why it's not. Oh, yeah, because basically we don't have the attribute of it. I mean, the string needs to be put over here. Perfect. So now you have the control on managing what's happening with the capture right there. I ended up saying that I was going to do array, and you can, so since I said it, and it doesn't work as well, because honestly, whenever you have this resample right here, so I'm going to put it the sample right there, and I know that I have the blur, So I'm going to put the ray over here, right? And I don't need to necessarily use the capture, but I will not have the same amount of detail because the ray is going to try to project. I'm going to put a minimum distance. And I'm not going to show guide geometry. I think there is a lift or something that, like, the jitter scale or... The problem is it's actually very expensive, so you do not necessarily want to do that. Or you can actually just use the intersectional normal, which might have the... Let me see, why is not doing that? Yeah, okay, so yeah. Basically, it's calculating the normals of the randomization for you, but at the same time, it might be more expensive, because in order to calculate the normals, you just have the wired deform over there. We can have it and see how much it costs, but it doesn't really matter. So I'm gonna just delete this guy. Just want to show you guys that it's possible. All right, now that we have the both of them, I'm gonna try to manage to create some sort of Voronoi. I need to use the restroom real quick, guys. I'll be right back, okay?
lost some rights.
Alright, I'm back here. Give me 1 second. So, let me put the capture. Alrighty. So now what we want is make sure that we don't have a lot of resolution on the cannon itself. Because I actually, there's a lot of polygons that we may not even need here. So let's do this right now. I'm going to put the height of the cliff a little bit less. So since I have the attribute right here, I'm able to just bring it down. And as you can see, anything that I do, even with offset and everything, it follows even with the walls over there, which is really nice. You may have issues later on with like really tiny little spots, but since we're gonna try to bring less resolution to the polygons, it may help. So let's try doing that first. I'm gonna try to get the curve that I had here, which is the resample. Let's see how much of resolution this is happening. Actually, I'm gonna just select that. True. Okay. If I change this guy to be, let's see, times 2. Let's see what it does at end. And we may have to change the noises, which is this gentleman. There's a resample node right here. And I'm going to bring this to be 0.5 perhaps. Maybe point. But I'm going to put like 0.7. Let's see if the refine helps. Okay, cool. Let's see, point frame. I think we should do less. Maybe 1. So now the resample itself, it's not necessarily following too much of the part of there. So what we can do here, we can do this at the end of the whole curve. So we might want to have all the detail here happening, and then we optimize whatever we have after. So this refine, I can actually go back to whatever I had before. Good. And now I'm able to just bring a little bit less resolution to whatever I had here. So now we know that this tolerance curve could be an attribute for resolution purposes. So I'm gonna make sure I have a parameter over here. And I'm gonna try to make sure that I have a separator and call this parameter res resolution threshold, I guess. Gonna apply. And this resolution threshold, since we know that the range is very, very small, I'm gonna test some numbers here, but let's try 0.001 and 0.1 and see if that works. I'm gonna apply. We definitely want the default value of this threshold to not be that way, because it can actually crash or even create other issues. So I'm going to select the resolution, bring it to be 0.0001. except, let's see if the number is there. Okay, so it's not necessarily that small. Let's put a little bit more, sorry. I'm gonna put it to be 0.025, there you go. And then this guy, that is a lot, so I'm gonna put it to 1, and this gentleman to 0.1. And safety net, I'm gonna lock those two ranges, and now copy this guy to the tolerance V, paste, and now we are able to change the resolution, and it's gonna happen over there for us. Since I'm creating this divide right here, okay, I may actually not want to create this divide right now, and I'll show you guys later why. I'm gonna go back to whatever we have in the stylized terrain here, okay, and it's not necessarily doing the same work over here because we ended up creating different things inside of the whole situation right there. So instead of actually doing this reference here, I'm going to try bringing this whole amount of nodes right here. I'm going to put a copy, create a reference copy of everything here, and then cut and paste over there. I'm going to put another subnetwork. Actually, no, just bring this guy here. And I'm going to paste those nodes there, which are the reference copies. And it's not showing anything because I have to connect something. Should be showing what's going on. Let's see. Yeah, so, yeah, that's going to be a nightmare. Ugh. Okay, let's do the easier way. I'm going to bring all those nodes down. Actually, the harder way. I'm going to bring all those nodes down, and I want to make sure that I have no more subnetwork for now. So I'm going to try to extract contents. Let's see if it breaks. It doesn't. Perfect. Now I'm able to get a reference copy of these guys. Bring you here. Well, we could. No, but no, because honest, not necessarily. Yeah, it's using the. Let me think. Yeah, it needs to use a triangulate 2D first, I believe. Could try getting without the triangulate 2D right now, since we didn't put it after. Let me think. Yeah, we can put it after, I guess. And we don't even need the reference copies right here, so I'm gonna try deleting this. Now, triangulate 2D is basically, guys, to avoid any sort of situations where there's too many like little tiny convex shapes, and we don't want that. So give me 1 second. See if this works now. I'm gonna put this skin right here since we have those two curves. Where are the curves? What am I doing here? Okay, so I have the skin. Let me see if this works without. No, yeah, that. No, we're gonna have to have the triangulated. Oh god, I didn't think. Since I have the two curves right there, I have the skin right here. Yeah, okay. Yeah, we're gonna have to create a triangle 2D before, which is totally fine. Okay. And on the blur of the curve itself, there's one blur that I remember we did that actually needed to have the group to actually hold the endpoint and both actually. The endpoints, so we need to do that as well. So I'm gonna try to bring, yeah, this skin. So I'm gonna bring all those nodes down again. It's a good behavior to organize it first, yes, but it's sometimes impossible because you don't necessarily know what's going to happen. And you don't know what you're going to change. That's the beauty of nonlinear, but at the same time, you have to put your mind through it. I'm going to call it let's put it here. Main end points. But it has to be before the skin. Nope, let me think. Oh, this guy. I'm trying to think. One sec. How am I going to solve this? Because it's necessarily blurring these two. So let me see if it blurs the endpoints right here. Yeah, it does. Okay, so it's here. So I'm going to have to put this guy here. And copy the name of it. Make sure it's points 1 1 invert range, and then exclamation point. Not that. I'm just gonna call. Yeah, there you go. And then exclamation point main inputs. Perfect. Just to be safe that we know that the curve is gonna follow later. And then now that I have all this attribute, I mean these nodes over here. Let's see if it tests and corrects. Perfect. And I see that is actually doing the endpoints right here as well, so we may end up having to find a different solution. Let me think. Okay, so the resample itself is creating a lot of stuff here, and it's blurring. I mean, it's getting those endpoints right here to be kind of sort of like subdivided. We may not want that. So let's play around with that. How we're gonna make this happen is by, so we do, we know we have the two curves right there. Let me see if I'm able to do it this way. Try rows and columns. Okay, I know what we need to do. Okay, since we have, it's a difficult mindset. But so now we have the zero and the end group of each line. So I'm gonna make sure that I have group by range over here, and I'm gonna call this group and lines, and this time I do want the primitives to be there. And as soon as I do that, we should have the invert of just those two. And what we want to do is delete. Oh no, that's not gonna work. Oh my god, what I'm gonna do. Okay, rows and columns. Oh yeah, the second. Yeah, delete the rest. No, not this guy. End lines. Right, and then invert the selection. And then we're going to do a merge. And if I bring those two, and I only use this guy to actually beat the rows, I mean the columns. We have both groups. And now we know that we are able to have one in the triangulation, right? Which is this guy, and the other one not in there. So I'm able to bring this to the triangulation node. And it's not showing anything because we need the edges. There you go. Let's see if this actually works correctly. So I'm gonna try to play around with the curve for now. Sometimes it kind of makes it disappear, which is not a good idea. So I think there's something with the blur part over here. Let me see. Yeah, maybe the blur of the normal is actually too much. We may have to change that. Let me think. Blur curve. Let me put it to the skin again. which blur is actually causing the problem? That's the question. This blur seems to be okay. It's completely weird that it's actually... Oh, okay. I see why. What did I do wrong now? What the hell did I do wrong? It's hilarious. Oh, I do know. Ugh, the grid. Because the height of it... So basically what happens is... I have this height of the points, and it's not snapping to the grid, which we should. So now if I bring the points to be on the grid, which is not happening, I'm trying. Gosh, what's going on? There we go. And the second one, which is this middle part, we definitely want to do make sure that this is huge. So I'm going to bring this spacing to be 1:1, maybe 4:4. There you go. And then we don't necessarily need the auto grid. So now I know that I'm able to bring the points correctly, exactly to the zero part of it. And we do know that this guy actually could be done by creating a sweep, but I'm not going to try to deviate so much from what we already done before. But I will show you how to do the sweep, at least. There's a new sweep node in Houdini, which enables you to, let's just say we have the curve over here, which is the with all the blur and everything, and I'm able to bring the cross section over there. So it actually creates the shape for you just fine. But there's plenty of things here that you guys can play around with. I like to think that I am able to customize however I want, so this is the reason why I'm not using the sweep. It's a good note, don't get me wrong. It's just, you know, I like to play around with my noises and put every single attribute the way I want and not have to rely on a node that is already done. Okay, now that I have that, let me think. Let's just say we had, there's one, to make sure that this is safe, that to for us to play around on the grid, we can actually lock it down by ray tracing the bottom part. So I'm gonna try to do that. As you can see, my mind just like keeps going everywhere with how we're working on this. And I actually like it because I learned different things. And you guys hopefully get to understand better too. So now I have this grid, I'm going to call it grid snap, let's just say. And since I have this curve right here, I'm going to actually make this huge. Let's put it. 1,000 to 1,000. Or what we could do as well, which some people might would like to know, there's a node called match size. And this match size is basically if I have one of the last let me think. Let me put it as a... Yeah, so let's just say I have this curve, right? And I'm gonna try to match the size of this curve to whatever this grid is doing. And then if I go to the match size and scale to fit, the grid itself, which has too many points, we don't need it. I'm gonna put this to 1:1. We don't need it anymore. So basically the curve itself, the grid will exist. But the problem is if we change the curve right here, right? It's gonna happen this way. But now I know that it's going to match the size and I'm able to ray trace it back the height of the curve or whatever we do on those points right here. So I'm going to try... Perfect. And then bring this guy there. I know it's a little confusing, but I'll show you what am I trying. I'm trying to do. So now that I have the ray... Even if I go up, okay, so I'm gonna put this as project race and vector. I'm gonna delete every single reference thing here, and I'm gonna try to put this one for now. Let's see what this does. So now that I have here, I'm gonna try to bring this point up without the grid, right? Yeah, you can see now that the other curve which we're selecting here, it's still on the ground. I mean, it's not necessarily entirely, but what we can do is, since it's matching the size of it, we need to make sure that is the minimum, I believe. Let's see. Yep. No, it's not that, Hugo. Yeah, okay, it's not that. So what we can do is, oh god, we do not want anything on the y-axis, I believe. Let's see. We still want the node to follow, and I also want to make sure that I transform this node and bring you a little bit larger. So I'm going to try to scale this guy out. Let's see if this now does the job. Nope. What am I doing wrong? We're going to try minimum distance. Okay, perfect. Yeah, that's better. So now go to the curve, and we know that every single node, even if we put up on the any axis, it's going to try bringing the curve down on that platform, or let's just say. So it's just a safety net in order if you wanted to. My intentions with the Tori is going a little bit more 2D axis, because if we go 3D route, it may take a way longer time to find out solutions to create this terrain. So just let you guys know. And now we know that even if we go to the skin itself, which is right here, and triangulate 2D, we're safe enough to just do whatever we want with the height of the curve, and it's still gonna fall. Just as a, you know, to be safe. And let me try to bring the blurs too much. Okay. All right, finally. Sorry, I deviated too much. Right? On the triangulate 2D, I am going to try to bring this guy out here. And we have the normals right there. Now I know that we needed those curves, which are here. I believe, yes. And they all have entirely a bunch of noise. So we want to, there's other, definitely probably other ways to manage this whole situation, guys. I just can't think right now how I would. So I'm gonna copy and create a reference copy of those. I bring it here. And I want to do this, gentlemen. Get the same noise. Functionality. Let's see what's gonna happen. Okay, basically I don't want the triangle to be here, so I'm gonna delete. I do not need the divide. I do need resample. The noise is yes, yes. Perfect, okay. Okay, perfect. And then I'm able to have the whole situation happening, and it's causing issues. Let's see. I love debugging Houdini. Okay, I don't know why this is going there, so I'm being dumb over here. Yeah, this, I think it needs to go here. Okay, we're getting something, but we're still having problems. Let's keep playing around and finding out the solution. Da-da-da. Yeah, the copy of this node seems to be higher than the other one. I'm trying to find out why. Since the copy itself, okay, maybe it's this. Yeah, it's the same height. What the hell? Okay. I found the problem. And one of them is going down a lot and the other one is not, and I don't know why necessarily. So let me... Whoa. What do I do here? The peak is the same. Another one is doing the right. Why is this height different? Jeez. Okay, I did something because of the wire capture. I don't think the wire capture went to these guys. Yeah, I did it. Nail it. Okay, and I copy. But instead, well, yeah, I'm just gonna do this for now. But I'm having issues remembering if the subnetwork inside of that it actually is copying. So let's just not do a copy reference. So I'm gonna just bring this guy as it's being separate. Perfect. Oh my god, what am I doing wrong? Okay. It's getting on the floor, okay. Yep. Okay. This guy, it's interesting, I just copied the same thing. And it's not doing the job that I wanted to, so. Okay, yeah. Oh, okay, this is not a problem right here. Oh, God. I think that because we ended up changing the sort, let's see, so that's the case. Oh, all right. We know we have those two nodes right here. I think I'm doing something very wrong. Sorry. Okay, got the noises. Oh, yeah, duh. I need this guy here, not there. Oh, here we go. Alright, I think this should work now. Yeah, perfect. But the normal is inverted, so we are able to change that. Bye. How can I do this? Yeah. So yeah, this is the reason why the bipolarity or even the convexity, it causes the curve, and I could try doing a frame normal and all that stuff, but I don't know if it's gonna work, so I'm gonna just go easier route. I'm gonna template this, and we know that we have the formation there, and I want to reverse or not reverse this normal, and not reverse this normal, perfect. So it's causing some little issues here and there, and I do believe it is because we're using this guy here, so we don't want this. Let me just change, take every single surface over there so we know that. Nope. Yeah, this noise, for some reason, is not getting there. I don't know why. I think it's because I did this resample is different now. Triangle HD, divide. Yeah, I got it. Perfect. I do not want this to be subdivision curves. Let's go to the straight edges. Actually, we want to be subdivision curves, but I want to resample by polygon edge, I guess. Let me see. Ugh. Forgive me, guys. I'm like slow as hell today. I'm gonna use this as straight edges. There you go, better. And then, whenever we do this, because I already did a lot of blurs, so we're gonna be able to find ourselves to have both shapes in order. Oh, nope, my god, what am I doing? It's a pain to like debug and what do you mean sometimes, because you'll never know which one is causing what. Okay. Yeah, so this guy is probably not following some rules of daughter curve right there. I'm gonna fix this. Let's do this. we may not actually necessarily need to triangulate too deep. It's going to cause so many issues, and instead of actually trying to fix, I should solve this problem right here. Let me try to take any template away. Perfect. So I do want to, honestly, I do want to find a solution that fits those guys together, because yesterday I wasn't finding. I believe it's fit. We'll see. It's kind of... No, it's not. I'm going to try to use another triangulator 2D so we don't break the other one. It is doing it, so let's put as edges, I guess. Oh, no. I know its solution. Jeez. Oh, God. Batch. Yeah, poly patch. Or poly bridge too. We could do poly bridge. Okay, and then group 0, group 1. Since we don't have those groups over there, we might have to end up using a different method, which. No. I'm going to run. I'm sorry. Oh my god. Poly patch. Got this, okay, perfect. I'm gonna put this one version, and now I know that I'm able to get those curves right there, and the poly patch is going to follow with polygons, and I'm able to reverse this and divide right here. So if I'm gonna leave still this triangulate 2D, since I did this skin over here, let me see, why did I do this? It was just because of the triangulate 2D. Okay, perfect. See if that works. Because what happens is it. Oh no, my god. Yeah, guys, I don't necessarily know what's going on, so I'm gonna have to keep going with the cliff itself, and I'm gonna lose your guys' time. Something happening with the fact that of this divide, I guess. Because every single node over here is the same. I'm gonna copy everything again. This one? No. I do know what's going on, I guess. No. Okay. And this guy is supposed to be here. Because this one is the solid. It's causing issues, which we need to. We have the poly patch, we have the reverse. And now I do the divide, yes. But then this one divide doesn't exist, so it's which is fine. Oh my god, I'm gonna Okay, I'm just gonna continue, guys. We can do something a little bit different here, just like fuse those together or whatever, but I need to show you guys the cliff itself and not this. I'll find out, and as soon as I found out tomorrow, we'll be able to remediate later, okay? So, where's this resolution? I'm trying to bring the resolution a little bit higher so we can have a little more information. Oh my god, wait. Interesting. See, like, I'm having more points there. Oh, gotcha. Gotcha. I think I gotcha. Oh my god, no. I'm gonna cry right here. Jeez. Oh god. A little primitive. A long cord. Yeah, what the hell? I guess I could do the resample before the fact of the poly patch and delete this resample. No, but then it's not getting gentlemen. Be patient with me. I know. Not. Because the polypatch is actually causing the whole resolution here to go higher. Yeah, no. I can't. Not right now. My mind is not fully functional, so I'm just gonna leave the resample here. It's fine. And make sure that we have the divide on. Oh my god. You guys saw it that I did. Well, divide up on top of the resample. Perfect. Through the fact that we want to create the cliff, what we're going to do here is get into one of those, one of the walls themselves, so, and we, let's choose the right one for now. And since we have those normals not being corrected, I'm just going to put this normal right here. Perfect. And let's do this. We know that the normals of these walls have the skin itself has the shape, and the normals are pushing on that side. So we can do another curve, which is whatever we have here. So I'm going to bring this merge, which is this guy, and create another curve that is in the middle in order to create the shape formation to whatever it's outside on the top of the cliff. So I am bringing another transform node here. And this one doesn't necessarily need to push as the same way. I'm actually going to blur this less, by the way. It doesn't have to be that much. I'm going to put this 0.1. Not too much. Actually, we can do another peak. It's better. So we know this value is 5. I'm going to bring this to be 10, for example. Perfect. And then these two guys will have two outputs. So I'm going to create an output for this and an output for that one. And those outputs, I actually have to make sure that this guy is number 1. Perfect. Yeah, this should work. Okay. Yeah. And then on the subnetwork over here, I'm going to have both curves happening. The thing is, we need to know which number of each curve is happening right there. We can actually push a little bit more. We can also make sure that we have those values outside, but I'm going to save us time. Let's see what are the numbers of the curves. So put the normals off and everything. So now we know 0, 1, and 2, correct. And because the skin itself is going to do the job for us, we have this shape. Okay, perfect. Yay, cool. Now we go to the better part. I'm not sure if anyone has been playing. Is this currently... Oh, sorry, I forgot to see that. Is this currently UV'd? Wondering if it's pretty simple when you have... yes, it is very simple, and I can totally show that to you. It's a good question, thank you. What we're gonna do is come back to the whatever we have in the curve and make sure that this curve, the top part of the curve, whatever we have here without the copy, has a UV, right? So we were able to create this way. So we're gonna create a UV texture node, and this UV texture node. Is using the UV attribute as vertex, okay? So vertex is different than points in Houdini. So you have to understand the concept of both of them. A lot of people don't have like a really hard time about that. And we are able to change the scale of whatever the arc length of the whole curve is doing. So since we have all these points over there in this curve, if I press 0.5. Yeah, of course, Malcolm. My pleasure, man. I know there's a little delay on the video, but you guys will be able to get what I'm saying. Now, we know that we have this whole curve right here, but we do not want this to be just this way. So what I'm going to do here is create something called arc line splint, okay? And you want to have the arc length to have a specific value that is the length of the UV itself. So what we're going to do here is in the scale of the X, okay, just bear with me because I don't remember all the functions. So it's arc length. And then let's see what is there. I think it was arc length, yeah. It's not giving the tooltip. Why? Why are you doing this to me, Houdini? Okay, cool. So now you can see that it gives you a little bit of a preview of what it can do there. So I just want to make sure I'm doing the correct thing. Okay. So what we want to do here is arc length. I'm going to call the address of whatever the node that I want, which is, it can be, my keyboard is not working now. And I want the UV texture. Actually, I want the attribute wrangle, two. You are able to actually, I don't remember which one it was. I think it was just 2 points. You're able to get the top part. Yeah, I don't remember, but basically, where's zero? I think it was zero. Yeah, it just gets the last node that was before, or minus one. I think it's minus one. And then I do zero, which is the first point of the curve. I mean, yeah, specifically the point that you want to start the arc length. And then zero to one, which is the UV, right? The start of the curve and the end of the curve. And let's see if this works. Nope. There you go. I believe this works. So now you have the length of the UV. So you see that the curve is huge, right? And we have all these points being the arc length itself crosses the, let me see if I can take off the grid over here. Yeah, there you go. So you can see that I have the texture here and the arc length is calculated by the unit one and the whole line section is being ordered over there. So now that I can transform, I actually promote this UV of this curve to be points. I believe that we have to do this. So the attribute promote point, I'm gonna bring the vertex, and we know that there's attribute vertex called UV. And now this attribute right here, I mean the UVs themselves, are in points. So if we go on number one or number five, it doesn't change visually for us, but we can do that by, let's say I go here and show the geometry spreadsheet. And we know that if we go all the way down there, yeah, this guy is actually doing points. But if we go to the vertex, it doesn't show anymore. But in the first one, which we had here, it does. So pretty much I'm promoting an attribute. It's just it's just sending the information from one to another. All right, since I have this now, I am able to copy these guys together, and let's see if this works. Okay. All right, you can see now that every single curve has their own, how can I say this? Way of bringing in it, but the y-axis of each of those are not necessarily following, right? We have an ability to do that by copy those guys out. Let's just bring them to inside of those curves right here. Let's see which curve is this, okay. So I know I have this guy here, and I can have these two gentlemen's create copy, reference copy. And one will have four, one here and one there. Perfect. And now you can pretty much, not this one, I believe. Yeah, I was doing something wrong. These guys go here. Yep. I'm able to bring the UV texture of this to be offset on the Y, but all of those guys are going to offset the same because they are having a reference copy. Or I can just pretty much go to the second one and say, hey, I want you to not use that reference, and you can see it changes there, okay? So, or I can pretty much do a manual thing, which I think is maybe a little bit more organized. Let's see. Let me think about this. Since we are using the transformation inside of the node, we can find a distance in between them. I'm thinking. Yeah. But yeah, I'm gonna do that. Gonna copy the parameters of these. Let me see how big is this graph. Nah, it's kind of big. Yeah. Let's do this. I'm gonna bring every single thing to this graph first. Copy these guys in. Bring it there. Copy those noises here. It's a little bit more clean to see things happening. And I know that this is the point, I mean the curve one, and even though you can change the outputs anyway, I know I'm probably confusing you guys, but this is not number two, okay guys, this is number one. So now I know that I have this UV texture right here, and this the transformation of whatever we have on the peak side of things, we can copy those. I'm gonna actually duplicate that, or I mean create a reference copy. Bring this to be, just bring this down. I'm gonna change the outputs because it's gonna get confusing for people. We know that this is number one and this is number two. Or I'm gonna confuse myself as well. Okay. And then this output goes here, zero. And we're gonna be able to create another one. Perfect. Okay, now I'm able to bring this in here. Okay. And then UV texture itself, delete the channel. And the peak itself, bring the parameter to be on the UV texture. Bam. And do the same thing on this guy. So I'm going to create a reference copy. And right here. I'm doing the most complicated way, but there's way easier ways to do this. But it's interesting to find out how it's working. Copy. Okay, and now we have all three curves, boom, boom, and boom. And I think this is the second one, let's see. This is the first one, which is supposed to be on the floor. No, it's not. You go, jeez. So it's supposed to be, sure. Oh yeah, I know why. This guy goes in first in there. Okay, and now we have the third. I used to have a friend in California, which when every time I will say the third, it's like the third of the shit, and it's my accent. It's hilarious that I remember that. I believe that's what it is. Perfect. Okay. And then I go to skin, and I hope that, yeah, there you go. So now we have in between the distances, and we know that the UVs are happening right there. Oh my god, that took like a long time. So, and then I'm able to actually preview this. So if I use the preview mode, I'm getting old, I cannot even read things anymore. 4K monitors for working with Houdini, guys. I know I can increase the size resolution of the icons, but God, I'm so blind. Quick shape, sorry. And then I am able to see the texture itself happening right here. And the UVs are happening, just as a preview. All right, cool. So now that I have that, and I have the UVs and I showed you, I'm gonna try to bring some sort of crack information, or even sort of like any sort of sediment, or just very stylized sediment. How do I do that? All right, that's gonna be another whole section, but I'm gonna try to start today because I promised. I know I'm taking like a long time for things. You can do by, let's do a tri-divide, okay? And this tri-divide, I am going to bring a lot of resolution to this guy. I'm gonna have to put a little bit more. And root depth, let's see. I don't know why I'm not being able to see things here. Oh, yeah, I do need to make sure that it has triangles, of course, Hugo. I like to vary with the tri-divide because honestly, the tri-divide gives you a little bit more depth to whatever you're creating right there. You don't necessarily need to put that. And it creates this sort of like triangulation noise. You don't, whenever I create the subdivide, it doesn't give me much to play with, and it's much more expensive. And tri-divide is cheap, really cheap. So let's put this to be perhaps 2. There you go. The only problem of the tri-divide, I have to actually make sure that I have a normal right after the fact, which I do here. Perfect. Very nice. And now I'm able to create some sort of a, you put a maybe blur, yes. There you go. So you can see that I'm having some sort of differentiation of shapes and those triangles. I know it's high poly right now in a way, but it's really cheap to work with. And then I am going to use something called edge fracture. And the edge fracture itself, what it does, so just so you guys know, the blue lines are open vertices. It's not, if I put an explode right here, for example, kind of explodes the pieces for us, okay? Just letting you know. So this, it already gives me some options of like how the fracturing is happening. You can use it however you want, right? You can like you see like that I have plenty of shapes being formed over there, which is nice. But at the same time, I do not want to do it this way because it only you see that it gives me some sort of variation that I don't understand. Well, what the hell is going on, right? And I also want some sort of vertical cuts as well. So I'm going to hold this edge fracture here, but I want to make sure that I have some horizontal cuts. I mean, yeah, horizontal cuts before the tri-divide. So I'm going to bring it back here and make sure that this guy's going down. I'm going to bring, a knife. I don't know. It's funny, the name knife, but yeah, that's what they call. And the origin is 0 because it's actually the bottom part of everything. But the distance, as you can see, I'm able to cut over there. See, like it's getting that clipped per se. Okay. And I don't know why the knife itself is supposed to do that. I don't know if actually, the clip itself, I think it has it too. We can do that. Yeah. I think the clip is better because you're able to put all primitives. But it's still not, you see, like it still doesn't cut, which I don't understand why. So it's pretty much the same. It doesn't give me the edge itself. I think it's a bug, I don't know. What we could do is, I wish that it would give me the edge name of this, and then it doesn't. So we're gonna have to actually manage to do the clipping. Maybe there's another way that I don't know to do that. We can do booleans, but I've tried to avoid booleans as much as possible. Because it could give us issues. Let me try to see if there's a node here. No, okay. Yeah, let's just do with clipping because I think it's much safer. So I'm gonna put it above the plane. And we know that we have this cliff height value. So pretty much I'm gonna try to put this as the name as cliff I guess cliff faces. And in this clip node, I am going to bring a bbox function, and I'm gonna call it out the cliff faces, and I'm gonna use dy max, or you can use dy size as well. Actually, this is not supposed to be here. It's supposed to be on the distance, so I'm gonna bring you there. Why is it giving me error? No, it's not. Oh yeah. So I have the dy max, which I know the value is 7.1 because it's calculating from this gentleman. So I'm gonna divide this by 3, and you get the first line over there. Okay, which is pretty nice. All right, then I'm able to do the same thing here. I'm going to copy this parameter. There's actually other ways to create this, to be honest. But no matter what, we're out of time. And then we know that this value is right here divided by 3. I'm going to copy this gentleman and delete these guys. And I'm gonna do divided by 1.5, I believe. Yeah, or 1.25. It's up to you. Whatever you want your values to be. And then I'm gonna duplicate both of them. Actually, gonna copy reference better. Actually, this is not supposed to be a copy reference. So. And then copy reference those two. Yay. And then make sure that you break this down first, delete the channel first, because or it's gonna change the reference file. And then below the plane, let's see, yep. So now we know that, okay, this is there, but you see that I have another one here, which is creating that clip part. So I wanna do, let me see if I have, yeah. And then this one is, we need the middle part, which I don't know which is the right here. So I'm going to do this below. Perfect. And so we might not even need this. Forgive me. All right. We have the middle, top, but we actually do. Think. Now we do need that one. Sorry. Because this is the top part. So we're going to have to delete this reference. Something I'm doing wrong here. One second. Yeah, perfect. That's what sleep deprivation does, guys. You get a little slow as hell. All right. And then I merge all of these guys together. And then we have all this sort of like horizontal cuts. But why am I doing this way? Because if I actually go to the attributes themselves, and remember we had the cliff height, it's going to do this, right? It's gonna follow the height of whatever the cliff is doing. So this is the reason why I wanted to do it that way. And you can do booleaning. I recommend to try avoiding it as much as possible. It's very, very good, but I had a hard time with it in the past. So now that I have those cuts and I know that they exist, right? And I have this shape and form and I have the try divide, I'm going to bring the blur right there. And now I can use the edge fracture right here. Boom. And since I want to not get the initial piece, it's not going to show anything, but I am able to send a reference to whatever I had that before. The thing is, I had those horizontal parts all surrounding those surfaces. So we do not want those middle sections. So what we want to do here is create a divide node or a poly, where is it? No, I need to create a divide node first. This gentleman, I'm going to send it here and do the remove edges as you can see. So I only have the lines, and I can do the edge to fracture, and it kind of creates this sort of little noise here sometimes. It's hard to manage that. I don't know why it does it. You can try to resemble the accuracy, but yeah, this, there you go. Kind of, it kind of gives you that, the little parts of it, or you can just turn it off, but then you won't have the details. It's up to you. I try my best to just play around with those values and see how it goes. Okay, perfect. I'm gonna leave it that way right now. And now that we have this edge fracture, and so we have too much detail here. So I'm gonna bring this down a little notch. That is too much. Actually, no, that's good. I'm gonna do even more for. And this blur needs to change. No, that is not good. Let me think about it. I'm not gonna do that fracture before. I'm gonna do it after, to be honest. I'll leave the tri divide to be after, and then we can play around with the height. Or what we can do is get this to have some sort of noise initially. Okay, why am I not having this? I'm lost. Why am I not getting it? Yeah, I do have the guide. Oh, yeah. It's going to be a little bit hard. I'm going to put a subdivide for now. Just at least one or two. I'm going to use edge loop. And I do not want to shoot and sharp the edges. What the hell? Ugh. One second, guys. I don't want to divide here. Sorry. Let's do this here. Bam. Ugh, finally. Okay. So I'm going to put a lot of resolution there. And now that I have this here, it's pretty much going to give me the cuts in there. Or we could just, no, Hugo, you're being dumb as hell. We could just use this. Ooh. All right, perfect. Ugh, sorry guys. Not sorry at all. Put a step as one, and we can do this as volume preserving a little bit. And what we can do here as well, just to give a little bit more variation, we can get, let's put this value down. We can get a little noise attribute. So just put that in here. Again, I'm going with my mind right now. I'm not even like thinking necessarily how I was going to do this. There's no, for me, that's the beauty of how I like to work. Of course, if I have an objective, a goal, it's easier, but I don't even know what I was going to do. I knew I was going to create like a stylized sort of cliff with a road. That's simply it. Now we know that we have this noise right here. I'm going to bring it as is to be a noise that is 2D, which gives you some sort of noise of whatever's happening there. And I'm going to make this center noise. And since I know that this is going to be blurred, I'm going to call this perhaps cliff blur. No, hold blur. And this guy, as soon as I put this here, we're going to see some things happen. Okay. So you can see now that because I'm holding that blur, we can have some sort of variation happening, and I'm going to try to put out, and actually, no, we cannot do this as center. And let's try to see if I manage to have a little bit more Yeah, see, there you go. So now it kind of gives that those values to be a little bit more clamped or not. I mean, the variation of whatever the blur is doing. And we can come here and change that by amplitude and clamping. Boom, boom. There you go. It's not like a lot, but it just gives a little bit. And we can also do the gentleman of point. I'm going to create a blur. I'm going to create a normal. And right here on the top, I'm going to leave that there. I'm going to leave it here, actually, in the bottom for now. So just two variations that we could do here. So now that we know that we have normals on this mesh, I want to get away, normal. So you can see that we're just kind of like blurring the normals surrounding those parts, and we do want to do that because as soon as we try to devastate this mesh, it's gonna get into issues later. Here's fine. Oh yeah, we do want to pinpoint the borders, I believe. Let's do, oh my god, I'm not, yeah, it's always issues. Let's do views. Oh, let's do connectivity. So this is a little part that actually I find it really good to find whenever I was using Houdini like maybe 2 years ago. And it took me a while to understand how that connectivity worked and all the other things that I was doing. But this secret, I mean secret, no, it's not a secret, but basically I have, this connectivity will tell me that every single shape of that is separate. So I'm gonna put this attribute right here so you guys can see. Boom. So this connectivity tells me, it shows that I have three islands, right? It's just basically whatever mesh is separate, it's gonna call as an attribute. So there's one, two, and three, whatever. And it automatically does that for you, which is nice. And you can transform into groups if you want to. But as soon as I do this connectivity, I'm gonna call this primitives and say it cliff as an attribute. And whenever I press a middle mouse button, you're gonna see that we have a primitive attribute called cliff. But now I wanna fuse this, okay? And as soon as I fuse this, I don't know why it's not fusing, I do actually. Then we may have to create this subdivide later. It's fine. Now I know that I have this, I'm going to, as soon as I, well, this actually might not work, we'll see. Use something called primitive split. I don't think the try divide brings the attribute. Let me see. It does. So let's test. Yeah, and then cliff. So there you go. Now I am able to know that, hey, if I'm using a noise, right, or whatever I want to do later on, I am able to hold on to a specific connectivity and later on split it if I needed to, which gives me the potential of coming back and forth with those attributes. So even if I create an attribute right there on the top of the graph, I'm able to sometimes, not with all the nodes, to make sure that it separates later, okay? Just, it's a really good thing to do. And then now, I want to bring this to the blur. So instead of using the blur here, I'm gonna bring it to the divide. And we will see what this does. I'm gonna bring this blur right here as well. And we know that, okay, this is the normals, but we need to make sure that we have the other ones there. So I'm gonna, I know I'm like overcomplicating things here. Okay. Yeah, now I know. And then I will do something that as normal over here and do flatten X plane. So we know that all the normals are going in the very flatten method. And we do not wanna recompute any normals on these guys because we wanna make sure that it follows whatever we had here before, okay? And then the try divide, actually this node, not that one. And a dry divide. Well, finally, I think they fixed that. I think a version of Houdini was not doing that before. Now we know that this gentleman has this information, so I'm actually gonna take that off for now. Oh, I can use it. Let me see. Yeah, I'm not gonna call it a whole blur. Put it in normal here. No, I cannot. I do not want to do the normal after the fact. I'm gonna put as normal. Instead of actually using the blur to be like holding the normals there, we can just do a peak and then do the daughter thing later. I'm getting so tired, guys. I'm gonna have to finish in like 15 minutes. Sorry. I'm like really tired. So we know that we have this noise there, and this noise has to be 3D, of course, because actually it's a vector. And let's remap the noise to be all of those right there. And we know that we want this guys to be the minus one. Now we didn't even probably need the flatten before right there, so, but it's okay. And this needs to be additive or multiplicative. It's up to you, whatever you want to do, okay? So if you want to show your normals a little bit larger, you can do so. And why is it not doing daughter direction? I'm trying to find out. It's like kind of going in one sort of direction instead of all of them. It's like how, maybe it's the clamping, yeah. Good. Now we know that we have this, so I'm gonna peek this guy. Here. So we have some sort of like transformation of the normals of the surface. I'm gonna take off the normals, show whatever's happening right there. It's probably too much. And why did I want it to create that little blur? Because of the like very top of the edges. So I'm gonna put that here, but also hold the normals. Yeah, it's gonna explode because we're not clamping the value, so I have to create another noise right here and hold the blur. I'm gonna do a 2D and additive, of course. And then it's not center noise, just a higher amplitude. And then call this whole blur. And you notice now that I'm actually I'm trying my best to not touch any of the border corners, and it's still there. The issue will come, whenever we do this over here and we actually subdivide, is that it won't follow the curve whatever the floor is doing. So this is why the tri-divide is good, but at the same time it can cause issues, and I'll show you guys later why. All right, so now I do this, and I have the blur here. I'm gonna pull on volume preserving. It's too much. I think it's clamped. Ooh. Yeah, okay, so the intensity was too much, so that's why. And now the difference in between, it's hard to see here, but it will just kind of like, you give the noise first and then you take it away after, right? And then go to blur again. That is probably too much. It's just pretty much the tiny little bit not do any kind of, it doesn't damage the mesh. Now we have that. And I'm gonna make sure that this is points. My face hair is kind of cool. All right, so we kind of give that kind of sensation. And again, this is supposed to be low poly, guys. It's not high poly. This is the reason why I'm doing these tutorials. I'm not gonna go to high poly because the amount of things that you have to do to optimize your time, and it's a lot, trust me. But as soon as you do it, it's fantastic quality. And you can see that this noise that I'm having here, right, is, let me show you by color so you guys can see. I'm having it to be very, only horizontal. I don't want that. So I want to make sure that I scale this guy up a little bit more. And I let's put this as perhaps 5, and then this 0.2, 0.2, and let's see how that goes. And the simplex noise is not necessarily the best solution for this. Let's try Worley. Let me see what's going on here. 1 second. Maybe it doesn't have enough resolution, but it's okay. I'll try to like narrow you down. It's not still good, so. Pseudo-jabs-we. And then the peaking, let's keep going, guys, because I... And then, now we have a little more of that, and then peak a little bit more. Since this blur is doing this, and this guy is doing that, we have to hold the edges of the surrounding parts of the mesh. So you can see how many problems it brings to the table, but still, we can handle it. So I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do a group. I'm gonna call it hold borders. And this hold borders, call it to be points. Include by edges and unshared edges. There you go. And now I'm able to just peek on the points that are not the whole borders, as you guys can see. There you go. And there. So now we did have that primitive split, as you guys remember, but we're having some little issues here. I'm not going to try to solve this today, but later on. And then we're able to bring whatever we had as the edge fracture right here. You can see now that we have some sort of different cuts, and the fractures are kind of very varying here and there. And you can bring more or less, or you can create your own kind of reference over here. Usually, I do think that what this the edge fracture does over here in the initial pieces is basically a reduce. So you can, let's use it for now, for today. The only problems that I see here is just little tiny little parts like that are causing issues that may, whenever I do any sort of extrusion, it's gonna give issues. But we can fix this by doing a for each connect piece, and every single little piece I'm gonna create a fuse. Bam. And then just fuse every single part, and you can see that the difference right there. There you go. All right, and now that we did that, let's just decrease the amount of peaking over here. It's too much. And then also this noise, let's try getting the clamping. So we do a little bit more negative than the positive, because we might want to go out more than anything else. And there's also a little bit of curvature that we can do here, which is the bias. I'm trying to find the bias. There's no bias here though. Where's the comp? Yeah, they don't want, usually there was a thing where in the mountain, I mean, they do in the mountain node, but there's no bias over here, which kind of sucks. I wish they had. It's okay though. We can try to manage in different ways. Let me think. You can see the clamping is doing a little bit better job. Like, I want to make sure that I don't have too much of one direction. So let's try this. Put this negative and put this positive. No, it's not going to do a good job. Try another noise. Sparse convolution. It's kind of cool. It gives that kind of a interesting cliff, kind of eroded version. All right, let's go for it. Now that I have those polygons, and you can see that how a lot of those edges, and I'm going to use just one little part here so we can see, and just do a single pass, and then show that pass. I don't want that one. Yeah, I think this one is a little bit better to see. Let's see. Yeah. I don't want too much of all the, those triangles going up surrounding things here and there. And let's try to eliminate some little issues that have a lot of the measure of the curvature. So I'm going to put a measure or even area, actually. Or you can just use a reduced node, guys, to be honest with you. It doesn't really matter. Actually, this has to be in, so I'm going to try to bring this down. There you go. It the one thing that I had issues with is these boundaries, even if they are stiffening, they will still break later on. So I'll try to create a group and only do the reduce on the faces that you want. The issue is it's not just on, it's on the vertices, it's on the faces and not on the vertices. So may not be a good idea to use poly reduce. We can do something a little bit better. I think gonna put a group, and on this group I'm gonna call sharp edges. And in the sharp edges I'm gonna change this group type to edges, and I'm gonna bring the minimum and maximum angle, and let's try to get some angles here from there. So you can see that I'm getting all the little very sharp edges that are happening on the geometry, which is really nice, as you guys can see here. But I do not want to get the boundaries, right? Actually, I want to hold those guys. So let's hold those edges. Let's just say that. Perfect. And now I want to make sure that I have the dissolve. And let's dissolve those edges. Sharp edges, and not delete the rest. So you can see that I have sort of like a, you can even play around with those values right here, but just give the sense of like, okay, I'm getting some interesting formation of whatever it's happening, which is nice. And then I'm going to bring a blur. Blur. And it gives that smoothing parts of the scenario. And the solve itself, you do not want to bring this guy super up, because it's going to cut the boundary edges. I don't know why. Actually, no way. Yeah, you actually do not want to remove any of the of those inner points. So let's not do that. But also, there's one issue that it causes, which we have those little points. So we need to check the box, remove that degenerate bridges, and then divide this again. Oh. Whenever I say divide, guys, it's not necessarily divide, like subdivide. It's triangulate. And then we blur. We can use it this way. And then there's another thing that we can do, because we wanted to have those, the way that we were creating that mesh before. So let's just do this first. And then that guy now. Perfect. As you can see. We may want to use the Vaughn preserving, so let's try. And then edge length. Let's do lip shape. Okay. Just play with the values, whatever you guys feel it's better. There's many ways that you can handle that. And now that I have the divide, I want to put a gray into this. And bring this deformation that we have here to whatever the dissolve was doing, and do the minimum distance, but I do not want to use the borders, so I'm gonna sharp down, full borders, I guess. There you go. I think that's what it is. Oh no, I have to create another group, I apologize. Boom, boom, boom. Perfect, so now I have the border over here, which I don't want to touch them. I'm going to bring all those values right there. And then I do not want to use the group one, which actually I'm going to call it old points. And it doesn't exist because I didn't name here. All right, guy. I do not want the board to change. Let's see. Perfect. For now, let's try. I'm gonna try to take the show guide off. And you can scale this guy as well, guys. It's like you can exaggerate the sharpening parts of whatever you're doing. Okay. I forgot something that is really cool. Let's see if I can do that here. Whenever you're doing these edges, you might want to peek the surface out a little bit. So I'm going to peek those normals out before the divide. Actually, I want to peek before everything, because I want to hold the points. I know that I'm able to actually push a little bit of that formation out. And also want to make sure that I have an attribute blur that blurs the normals, so I don't get any issues with the peaking. So like it kind of blurs everything surrounding it, which is nice. And yeah, I'm actually literally putting the pinpoint over there. Let's see if this does. No. Okay, yes, I guess it's doing. But the peak itself was not getting the whole point, so we need to make sure that we have that. Perfect. So now you see that kind of brings the surface out a little bit. And then I do a blur, and I have a divide. And this divide is actually not going to convex anything for now, and I'm going to use the... This can crash, let's see. Not that one, sorry. Smooth polygons. We could use the bevel here, guys, to be honest with you, because you see how I'm getting issues with the edges right there. Let's try the bevel, or we're going to have to create another different thing later on. I have like maybe 3 minutes, but let me do bevel. Yeah, I'm still having those little triangles right there. That's going to cause tons of issues. I'm going to try to fuse them. I'm gonna put one. No, that's too much. 0.1, but do not change the borders. Perfect. And then bevel, let's see. I may have to create another fuse right after because very tiny little edges surrounding the whole surface. It's not, yeah, and then I need to borders. There you go. So, yeah, it's not holding the borders because honestly, we also need to promote the group that we have as group borders. But instead of promoting, I'm just going to put cold edges again. See, like, how painful it is. I'll just keep getting everything. But as soon as you do it, man, oh my god, it's a miracle. Cold edges. And then right here. Still not doing it. Oh my god. Yeah, I don't know why this bevel for sometimes it just for me just doesn't work. I tried plenty different things, but I'm not gonna play around with that right now. I'm just gonna keep going. But yes, you could do the bevel, guys. Apologize, doesn't work. And I'm not going to use the measure right now. And then as soon as I point out everything and I have all the surfaces and I take off the single pass, we will have this sort of kind of solution. As you can see, the peaking is causing problems. So I'm going to try to minimize it here by just the value amount because I really have to go. And then we can continue tomorrow. And now I'm able to create a normal map right here. And then bring this to be points and this to be face area. Voila, kind of started the solid parts of it, and it gives a little bit of sense of how we are able to create this. And I'm gonna turn that off. I'm gonna press Alt B, actually Control B. And you can see that kind of gives that, again, it's not done yet. We have plenty to do. We have still a lot that we need to fix and get that transformation going, but let me actually try to a little bit more here. 1 second. I need to find out why. I think it's the peaking that is causing the problem. Yeah, it's like I'm getting some little edges right there. Maybe the group. I'll sharpen edges. Then try 20. That's kind of interesting. So you can see, like, even if I change the edges that you're getting, we're starting to get some sort of better information. Let me try 5 and then 40. Ah, see? 20, 0. Mm-mm. Yeah, I'm gonna play around more tomorrow, but basically that's the idea. So we have some sort of really interesting information. And you can just extrude over here at the end if you want to. Right here. And just extrude a little bit, as you can see. And then just do another blur on the front scene. So we're gonna have to promote this group. I'll show again this tomorrow, but I wanna make sure that we guys at least have an interesting result to see today. Okay, we have those points being selected. We can blur them. Yay, perfect. Now we bring that normal right here. Just a tiny little bit of difference, but not a huge difference. And we can blur even more. And we're gonna fix all that stuff tomorrow. Yeah, there you go. So just gives the sense of, okay, what do you see again? Sorry, forgive me, and I didn't even read. But for bias, could use distribution rem perhaps? Yeah, you can. You will have to create a VOP or even code. You can bring that the curvature that you're wanting to of the noise by or the mountain node as well if you want to. But if you go through VOP over here, I'm gonna answer that question. You can go to point VOP, right? And inside of point VOP, you have the bias node, which you can use by the vertex the vertices of the normal, the vector of the normals, or by color or anything. So even if I go here, let me go back there. I don't remember where was that. I think it was here. So yeah, we had this whole blur, right, which is the noise itself. And we knew that we wanted to make the normals to have that bias from this specific noise. So we go inside of this guy and then bring the vector over here. And then we have this amount. And as soon as I do this, I have to make sure that this bias goes here. Yeah, kind of. You will have to get the vector. I won't be able to show this today, but it's too much. But basically, I get the vector to float, send it to the position, and create a ramp, exactly what you said, perhaps. But I'll show them up tomorrow. If you come tomorrow, I'll check it out. Just remind me. I'm like super exhausted, guys. Thank you so much for coming by. The result is here. Or tomorrow, or maybe Saturday. I'm not sure yet. And bam, we got some sort of really ugly cliff right now, but it will get better later. Thank you so much. Hope you guys have a wonderful night and you enjoyed seeing it.